Hello dear students, I am Chamla DP, lecturer in chemistry, AG Patel Polytechnic Institute, Solapur. Welcome to the second part of the practical related questions of applied science chemistry. So, question is, which ion makes the water alkaline? Okay, so alkaline, alkalinity causing ions. OH minus, that is hydroxyl ion, bicarbonate ion, carbonate ion, these three ions makes the water alkaline. Okay. Name the indicator used in the determination of alkalinity of water. Which indicators? Two indicators are used, if you are remembering. Okay. Here we are using the two indicators in the determination of alkalinity of water. One is phenolphthalein indicator, we are going to call it as a P endpoint, and next is methyl orange, that is M endpoint we are determining. So two indicators are used, phenolphthalein indicator and methyl orange indicator. Okay. Next question, caustic embrittlement in boiler is caused due to, when caustic embrittlement in boiler is caused, when your water which is used in the boiler, it is highly alkaline in nature, that time caustic embrittlement is occurring. What is caustic embrittlement and all that we have seen in our theory class. Okay. So remember, caustic embrittlement, it is caused due to the highly alkaline water if you are going to use it in the boiler. Next, what is the pH range of alkaline water? You must know, when you are saying that the water is alkaline, you must know the pH range for the alkaline. Okay, so the pH range for the alkaline water ranges between 8 to 14 pH. Okay, if it is above 7, then your water or which is fed into the boiler, it is called the alkaline water. Next question, which instrument is used to measure the turbidity of water? Okay, this is our experiment number 5, that is the determine the turbidity of water sample by nephalometric method. Okay, so here we are using the nephalometer or turbidity meter to measure the turbidity of the water. Okay, next, how to remove turbidity from the water? Okay, during practical also and during theory class also, I have explained how, what are the disadvantages of turbidity if it is present in your water. Okay, in textile also it is not good, it is not going to produce the proper stain. Okay, when you are using the dye to color your yarn. Okay, so turbidity, it is going to cause the bad effects, it is not going to give the proper color. So you have to remove that turbidity, and how you are going to remove? By chemical coagulation. Some chemicals are added, alum you are going to add, you are knowing alum, ferrous sulfate, it is added, and after that filtration, it is followed by the filtration to get the clear water. Okay. Next, what are the various units used to measure the turbidity? Okay. First is the standard turbidity unit, as you are knowing, ppm, part per million, or mg per liter. It is the standard turbidity unit. And next, JTU, that is the Jackson turbidity unit. This is also one of the unit used to measure the turbidity of the sample. Next is nephalometric method, nephalometric turbidity unit, NTU, which we are going to use today. Nephalometer, we are going to use the nephalometer, and using that we are going to determine the turbidity of water sample. What is the safe, next question, what is the safe level turbidity of drinking water? As suggested by WHO, World Health Organization, drinking water, it is said to be safe if its turbidity is less than 1 NTU. Okay, so safe level turbidity of drinking water is 1 NTU, nephalometric turbidity unit. Let us proceed further. Name the chemical used to calibrate the nephalometer. Okay, actually the name of that chemical is the formazine stock suspension. This chemical, it is used to calibrate the nephalometer. But how that formazine suspension is prepared? It is prepared by using hexamethylene tetraamine and hydrazine sulfate. These are used to prepare that formazine stock suspension. And that 400 NTU or sometime 200 NTU, this standard is used to calibrate your nephalometer. Okay. Next, on what principle Does nephelometer work? So what is the principle of that nephelometer? During practical also I have explained you. Okay, so the principle of this method, it is based on the scattering or absorption of light by solid or colloidal particles suspended in the solution. Your sample, that sample cell, if that sample cell consists of turbidity, okay, turbidity means what? Colloidal particles are there. When light is fall on that your sample cell, that time some of radiation is absorbed by that. If you are going to use the distilled water, directly all the radiation, it is going to give 100%, all the light is transmitted, okay. But here, when colloidal particles are present, they are going to absorb the light. Okay, and this principle, it is used in the working of nephelometer. What is the turbidity reading of distilled water? Yes, and question just now I said to you, what is distilled water? Distilled water, it is a very clear water. So, reading, turbidity reading for the distilled water, it is the zero. Remember, because incident light, it is totally, completely, transmitted. It is going to pass away from that distilled water. Okay, so you are going to get the zero turbidity reading. Now, what is proximate analysis? Okay, experiment number 6, determination of moisture and ash content. Okay, so proximate analysis in theory class also, chapter number 6, fuels and combustion, in that we have seen what is proximate analysis. So, this is analysis of fuel which involve, what it involves? It involves determination of percentage of moisture, percentage of VM means volatile matter, percentage of ash and percentage of fixed carbon. It is determined in the proximate analysis. Next question, name the furnace used to determine percentage of ash in coal sample by proximate analysis. Okay, in proximate analysis you are going to determine the percentage of ash by using which furnace? By using Muffle furnace. Muffle furnace, it is used to determine the percentage of ash. Okay. Next question. Depending on mode of heat generation, Muffle furnace is which type of furnace? Okay. In the beginning of chapter 4, we have learned the types of furnaces. Okay. Depending upon mode of heat generation, there are the two types of furnaces. One is combustion type and another is electric type. In combustion type, fuel is used to generate the heat. Okay, combustion means dwellon for the combustion of the fuel, for combustion heat. Using, when you are going to generate the heat by combustion, that time some fuel is needed. Okay, so in muffle furnace, it is an electric type furnace. So remember, it is an electric type furnace. And your blast furnace, it is the combustion type of furnace. Next question number 40. To determine the percentage of moisture in coal sample is heated at what temperature in hot electric oven? Okay, if you want to determine the percentage of moisture, you have to determine the percentage of moisture. So, for that you have to heat it at the 105 degree Celsius. Okay, and if it is asked for the determination of percentage of ash or percentage of ash in muffle furnace, you have to heat up to 750 degree Celsius. Okay, in muffle furnace you have to heat for the determination of percentage of ash, it is the 750, and for determination of percentage of moisture you have to heat it at 105 degree Celsius in hot electric oven. Next, name the elements that are combustible in the fuel. Okay, so combustible material already we have seen, carbon, hydrogen, sulfur. These are the elements which are combustible, which is present in the fuel. These are the combustible elements. Okay, nitrogen, it is not the combustible, it is a non-combustible element present in the fuel. So, let us proceed further. Next question, what is the important factor in fuel selection? Okay, there are the two important factors which is going to decide whether your fuel is good quality or not. First is the calorific value. Calorific value, it is nothing but the total amount of heat generated by complete combustion of unit weight or unit volume of the fuel. It is called the calorific value. And another is the ignition temperature. So, these are the important factors during the selection of fuel. Next, to cool the coal sample, Which equipment or glassware is used to avoid re-entry of moisture? Okay, one glass jar-like structure is used, and that it is called the desiccator. So desiccator is used to cool the coal sample. Okay, to avoid re-entry. Re-entry bole to here first we are removing the moisture, and again if you are going to cool it in the open, that time moisture from the atmosphere it is again entered. So to avoid the entry of that moisture, it is cooled in the desiccator. Name the substance which is present in the desiccator. So which substance is present in the desiccator? Remember, anhydrous calcium chloride, white color powder is there. That is the anhydrous calcium chloride. It is present in your desiccator. Sometimes silica gel is also used. Okay, calcium carbonate is also used. Okay, which is going to absorb the moisture. Next question, proximate analysis is qualitative or quantitative type analysis? Very nice question, very interesting question. See here, in proximate analysis, you are going to determine the percentage of moisture. Percentage means it is a quantity, you are getting some quantity, right? In volatile VM also, you are getting the quantity. So this proximate analysis, it is a quantitative analysis. You are getting some quantity here. So this is a quantitative analysis which decides the quality of coal sample. From this quantitative analysis, you are going to determine or you are going to decide the quality of your coal sample. Next question. Which type of titration is there in the determination of chloride content in given water sample? Okay, so when you are going to determine the percentage of chloride in the water sample, it is the precipitation titration. Remember, it is a precipitation titration. What is the color change at the end of determination of chloride content in the water sample? Okay, here the color change is yellow to brick red. This is the color change. Name the salts which produces chloride ions in water sample. See, calcium chloride, magnesium chloride. During sterilization, chlorine gas is bubbled in water. That time also chloride ions, they are entered in the water sample. Okay. Name the indicator used to determine chloride content in the water sample. Which indicator is used? Here, potassium chromate. Potassium chromate indicator is yellow color, is low color. Potassium chromate is used as an indicator. Next question. What is the formula of lime and limestone? Very simple question. For lime CaO. The formula of lime is CaO, and limestone it is CaCO3. This is the formula of limestone. What is the nature of lime solution? Yes, you are knowing there are the three nature: acidic, basic and neutral. Okay, all you are the aware, lime solution, it is the basic in nature. Okay, this lime, it is a basic in nature. Name the substance which is added during the preparation of lime solution for quick dissolution of lime. Okay, so sugar or sucrose, it is added 1:1 proportion, means 20 ml water is taken and 20 gram sugar is taken. They are dissolved, and that solution, sugar solution, it is added in the lime for its quick dissolution. Name the types of lime. Okay, we have covered this part in theory also. There are the various types of lime. High calcium lime, it is also called fat lime, poor lime or lean lime, hydraulic lime, dolomite lime. Hydraulic lime, again three types: feebly hydraulic, eminently hydraulic, and hydraulic limes, feebly hydraulic, eminently hydraulic. These are the types of hydraulic lime. Okay, so these are the few important questions which may be asked in your practical exam. Okay, so be ready for your practical exam, and wish you all the best for your upcoming theory exam, which is starting from 22nd June to 3rd of July. So all the best. Thank you.